Welcome to today's video. Today's video, I'm joined by Euan McTurk, who is a battery chemist for Discus by day, and by night, he is a YouTube editor who explains pretty much all the questions that us YouTubers can't answer and we don't understand properly. We refer to Euan. And on Twitter, you are?
At 106 Euan.
At 106 Euan. And the link for that is down below. Euan is my go-to guy if I'm ever stuck for questions on Zoes and batteries and how things work. And so far, you've never not answered me a question, so.
I suppose you're so persistent, that's the key.
So. Yeah, I do pester.
It's all good questions, so I'll give you that.
Yeah, I think you regret giving me your number now.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm glad I've still got my own private number, you don't know about it.
But. Yeah, no, that's fine then. So one thing that I was discussing with you privately on Messenger and also on Twitter publicly, which was we were talking about battery charge rates, C rates. So obviously the new Renault Zoe that's coming out is only got 50 kilowatt charging speeds.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if there's a way that, if it's something to do with the way they build the chemistry in a cheaper way. And you were saying there's another reason why, what's the theoretical limit of a 50 kilowatt battery in charging speed?
Right, well, really it's best looking at the C rate of the individual cells and what they're capable of doing. And then also looking at the amount of heat that they are dissipating and then how close they are to the rest of the cells in the pack, what the thermal management is and so on. So if we go back to sort of the dawn of the modern electric vehicle, the likes of the 24 kilowatt hour Nissan Leaf, which could charge at 50 kilowatts on CHAdeMO. Admittedly, I've not seen my own 24 kilowatt hour Leaf pull 50 kilowatts before, but typically EVs throughout the last 10 years or so, even though some of them have had stupidly high charging rates like Tesla's, charging currents, I should say, it's actually not been a very high charging rate. It's been about 1.5C to 2C. Now, the C rate is a relation of power to capacity. So it's the power, charging power, divided by the capacity of the pack. So for example, 50 kilowatts CHAdeMO divided by 24 kilowatt hours for the Leaf is about 2C.
Yeah,
and that's pretty much on the money. Most lithium ion cells are quite happy at 2C for rapid charging. But of course, you have to remember that the higher the charging power you put in, the more the internal resistance of the cell pushes the voltage ever higher. Okay. And you don't want the voltage to go too high because that's when you start to damage the cell. So it will reach its maximum voltage quicker with a higher charging power, with a higher C rate, and then it needs to start tapering the current off more.
And I'm presuming the C rate is also the same thing that dictates how much acceleration is put in, because obviously it's how much power you're pulling out of the battery. So I presume same C rate is the same going in and out.
Absolutely.
Both ways.
Yeah. It applies both ways. And cells get hotter when they charge at a given C rate than they do when they discharge at a given C rate, give or take. I mean, there's different phase changes, different subtle bits of electrochemistry going on throughout, but overall, as I say, there's more heat dissipated during charging, and that's why it's important to have adequate thermal management. The Zoe does this by redirecting the air conditioning through the battery pack, which, you know, it's a modest effort, it's quite a clever effort, but then again, air doesn't have that same thermal mass, that same ability to remove heat as a liquid thermal management system.
Yeah.
So, you know, systems like the new Peugeot E208, which is going to be, it's going to have liquid cooled batteries. I think it's going to be 50 kilowatt hours and it can do 100 kilowatt rapid charging. That is again 2C.
Are they not quoting 80 though? I thought they were quoting 80 kilowatt charge rates.
Oh, are they? Oh, no, yeah. I thought it was. They've possibly downgraded it since that last year. I thought it was 100. But I know the e-Niro does 80 kilowatts.
Okay.
But yeah, I stand corrected if that's the case.
I'll double check. I'm not. Yeah. I might be wrong. I'm sure I read 80.
I bet you 50 pence. I see. Are you a gambling man?
Ooh.
Oh, well, anywho. So again, it's 2C. But bearing in mind that the energy density of those cells is so much more, and their internal resistance, typically, the more you increase the energy density, the more capacity you squeeze into a given size of cell, the higher the internal resistance will be with lithium ion chemistry, and then the more heat's dissipated. So it's important to be able
to. So obviously, as battery chemistry is improving and we're squeezing more kilowatts per cylinder cell, we are squashing that chemistry into smaller space, so it's heating up more because there's less airspace between it.
Yeah.
I mean, what's the best form factor then for the battery for heat dissipation? Is it sandwich cells? Is it cylindrical? Is it the same as what BMW do, which is the Are they in like a prismatic casket?
Yeah. Prismatic, chunky boxes. Yeah. I mean, to be honest, there's advantages to each cylindrical Tesla. I've obviously made that work very well. You can squeeze it into all sorts of strange spaces. But I've seen really good thermal management systems for all three form factors of cell. So Tesla with the Model 3, they've managed to develop a sort of waved sort of tubing, if you wish, of coolant that runs between the cells. Yeah. And that keeps the packs really cool in their sort of optimum condition, even when you are beasting a Model 3 around the circuit. The Model S has a tendency to overheat after a few hot laps on Silverstone, for example, but the Model 3, they've learned from the mistakes.
Yeah.
The best example for pouch cells is probably the GM, the Chevy Volt, the range extended electric vehicle, not the Bolt. They massively over-engineered that battery pack in the best possible sense of the word.
Right.
So what they did was they had liquid coolant running through little metal ribbed channels that were in between all of the pouch cells. So they were sandwiched by these little ribbed channels of coolant. And on top of that, as well as having like a really high level of thermal management, they also only used about 60% of the capacity of that battery. They blocked off the top and bottom 20% of the capacity just to avoid degradation. And that's why even in hot climates like California, when the original Leaf, which didn't have thermal management, the batteries were falling off a cliff, there was a class action lawsuit about it, the Volts just kept running and running. And there's a guy over in the States who has a Chevy Volt that's done 400,000 miles and there's no noticeable degradation on the battery.
Wow.
It's maybe degraded within that top 20%,
okay,
but we don't use it, so we'll never find out.
Okay. Something I do want to explore. So many times I've spoke about checking your state of health on the Zoe by using something like Leaf Spy, similar to the Nissan. But what I've been told by a Tesla technician that I've known in the past, that those figures are kind of made up.
Yeah.
Oh, right, okay.
It's best guess. It's kind of wibbly-wobbly stuff.
Okay.
But it's based on, you know, semi-intelligent guesses, really. Because the only way you can tell what the state of health of an EV battery is, the state of health has a couple of definitions. One of them is the internal resistance versus new, which will increase over time as the cell starts to degrade and lose its performance. And one of them is the capacity. For hybrids, you're more interested in internal resistance. Again, they only use about 50-60% of the capacity, but they need the power there. Small battery, lot power to power the motor for a short period of time. Electric vehicles, you're more interested in the capacity for range. And the only way to tell for sure what the capacity of the cell is, the state of health of the cell is to fully charge it to 100% and then discharge it all the way down to zero. And that's not just taking into account what the dashboard's telling you, that's overriding that and taking up to the cell's real maximum and down to the cell's real minimum. Because as I said, there's those buffers at the top and the bottom.
To protect the battery.
Yeah. So the only way you can do that really is to take the battery out of the car and run it in a lab to be sure. So yeah, it's all, as I say, algorithms that are based on, you know,
So the state of health, is the algorithm using the car's charging data, or is it looking at the overall voltage between the cells in the packs, or is it mainly just an estimate of the age and the mileage of
it's an estimate based on all the previous stuff you mentioned. So you know, in terms of the typical mileage that a user's getting between, you know, fully charged and whatever percent it was taken down to, and then the car can make a best guess estimate on how much remaining capacity there would be, looking at the voltages of the cell at those points, that sort of thing. Each manufacturer is probably going to have its own definition of algorithm to go about that. But my day job, as you mentioned, is Ducozy. We're a bit more clever than that, because we have, instead of a rat's nest of cables that are connected across the cells, we have cells, each cell in the battery pack has a chip embedded in it. And that's wirelessly relaying the voltage, temperature, current, state of charge, state of health. It has the history of the cell on it. It has any abuse conditions. So it's right next to the heart of what's going on. And through machine learning and through advanced algorithms, we are improving its ability to predict the remaining useful life of that cell and the state of health of that cell.
Right. Thanks very much anyway, Euan, for joining me.
Thank you. If you
want to learn more about battery tech, Ewan's got his own Plug Life television where he goes into far more detail on this thing. If you're really interested in learning about an EV technology-wise, Euan is our go-to man, and he should be your go-to man. And go and click subscribe. Euan makes the most interesting content ever. The only warning is, once you get down that rabbit hole, you'll end up watching his entire series.
Yeah, apologies.
Yeah, sorry about that. So if you click over Euan's face, there should be a subscribe link. If you click over my face, a subscribe link. Give this video a thumbs up, and thanks very much for watching. Cheers, Euan. Thanks for coming.
Cheers. Thank you.